But to hold unforgiveness in ourselves, unforgiveness can be like a cancer and eat away and cause you to become a bitter person and just take the life and joy out of your life. And ultimately, and prevent you from allowing the love of God to fulfill itself in your life, and you might not be able to be used as God sees in that moment, whatever it might be, because you're harboring unforgiveness within yourself.
Wait on you. We Strength Exalted, he is exalted. blessing and honor and glory and power unto the Lord be praised. Sing with a chorus resounding before us, holy is his name.
Blessing and honor.
Blessing and honor and glory and power unto the Lord be praised. Sing with a chorus resounding before us, holy is his name, his name.
Watching by television, welcome to Fairton Christian Center, Fairton, New Jersey. Many of you are up in the Reading and Allentown areas, Philadelphia, up by Burlington in New Jersey, and we consider you to be part of our family, just like those of us that are here. A lot of our families out wandering all over the United States today. Our Royal Rangers are out for a week, and different people are on vacation doing different things, but the Holy Spirit is here, God is here, and we're gracious for that, and we are honored to be able to come in and be a part of your life. Thank you for watching and even praying as we minister the Word. We believe that the truth of God's Word will come alive in your heart, and the things that He does for us, He'll do for you, because He is not a respecter of persons. I wasn't planning on being here today. I was planning on being in Minnesota. And so about 2 months ago, I asked one of our young men who recently graduated from Valley Forge Christian College up in Phoenixville, Pennsylvania, if he would speak. And he agreed to do that. And then whenever our plans fell through to be away, I said, I'm not going to take that away from him. I'm going to give him that opportunity. And right before he comes to speak, I'd like to read a couple of scriptures that the Lord gave to me real early on in the ministry here. I wasn't the pastor of the church, and I was running a Royal Ranger program, and it was very difficult because the boys really weren't coming to Royal Rangers. That's like a Boy Scout program, because they wanted to know about Jesus. They were coming just because they wanted to have some fun. And it was like herding cats, trying to keep them all together and keep him under control. And I had invested some personal money into the program. And there's a corner over here where the Holy Spirit has spoken to me many times as I was either coming to church or going from. And I said in my heart, I said, I'm done. This is it. This is my last night dealing with this. I'm closing the program down. And the Holy Spirit spoke to me as forcefully as he ever spoke to me. And he said, be not weary in well-doing. For if you faint not, in due season you will reap. And I'm thinking, oh, Lord, really? He said, don't give up. Don't give up. So we persevered on, and it wasn't but just a few months after that that the pastor of the church, Sister Scholl, went to be with Jesus. And I remember being at her funeral, and my heart was broken. I'd never had a pastor that loved me like she did. I don't think I ever had a pastor that cared for my soul like she did. And when she passed away, it was like I was just broken inside. And I went home, and I opened the Bible up after the funeral, and the Lord spoke to me from the first chapter of Joshua. And it says, my servant Moses is dead. Now you take this great people across that river Jordan. And I knew the Holy Spirit was speaking to me, and you just have to accept this for what it's worth. In my mind, I thought, who can ever replace this woman? Because she had been such a powerful force in my life. Who can ever replace her? I can't replace her. Moses, my servant, is dead. And that was even before I knew that the Assemblies of God was going to call and ask me if I would step in as an interim pastor and take the church. God had prepared my heart for when that call came. And then there were so many different times that it was so discouraging. I continued to teach in the public school for 3 years, and at any time I could have just backed off that because getting close to, I was on tenure and not that far away from retirement in that sense. And we took the steps of faith that we needed to, and the enemy came at us in varieties of ways, which he'll come at everybody in varieties of ways. We weren't special because of that. But as you went through these things, I'm thinking, why am I that important? Why is Shirley and my relationship here in the church, why is it that important? And as I was preparing this morning to come to church, I felt the Lord deal with me and say, well, what if it really wasn't you that was the important one? What if it was the ones that I was going to use you to help prepare that were the important ones? What if those people, and specifically young people, that the Lord has brought to this church over the years and to the school were the reasons why we had to persevere? What if it was upon them that the latter rain was going to fall? What if they are the ones that God is going to anoint to take the church to its conclusion before Jesus comes for it in the rapture? Maybe that was why some of us who are older have had to persevere. It's not about us. It's about them. And in Isaiah 54 is a scripture that the Holy Spirit used to confirm his call upon my life. And it says, for this is as the waters of Noah unto me. For as I have sworn that the waters of Noah should no more go over the earth, so have I sworn that I would not be wroth with thee, nor rebuke thee. For the mountains shall depart and the hills be removed, but my kindness shall not depart from thee. Neither shall the covenant of my peace be removed, saith the Lord, that hath mercy on thee. It says, in righteousness shalt thou be established. Thou shalt be far from oppression, for thou shalt not fear, and from terror, for it shall not come nigh thee. Behold, they will surely gather together, but not by me. Whosoever shall gather together against thee shall fall for thy sake. I've created the smith that bloweth the coals in the fire, and that bringeth forth an instrument for his work, and I have created the waster to destroy, and no weapon that is formed against thee shall prosper, and every tongue that shall rise against thee in judgment thou shalt condemn. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their righteousness is of me. In verse 13 of that scripture it says, and all thy children shall be taught of the Lord, and great shall be the peace of thy children. And then in Isaiah 58, it's talking about the acceptable fast. It says, is not this the fast that I have chosen, to loose the bands of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens, and to let the oppressed go free, and that you break every yoke? Is it not to deal thy bread to the hungry, and that thou bring the poor that are cast out to thy house? When thou seest the naked, that thou cover him, and that thou hide not thyself from thine own flesh. Then shall thy light break forth as the morning, and thine health shall spring forth speedily, and thy righteousness shall go before thee. The glory of the Lord shall be thy reward. Then shalt thou call, and the Lord shall answer. Thou shalt cry, and he shall say, here I am. If thou take away from the midst of thee the yoke, the putting forth of the finger and speaking vanity, and if thou draw out thy soul to the hungry and satisfy the afflicted soul, then shall thy light rise in obscurity, and the darkness be as the noonday. And the Lord shall guide thee continually, and satisfy thy soul in drought, and make fat thy bones. And thou shalt be like a water garden, and like a spring of water, whose waters fail not. And they that shall be of thee shall build the old waste places. Thou shalt raise up the foundations of many generations, and thou shalt be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of paths to dwell in. If thou turn away thy foot from the Sabbath, from doing thy pleasure on my holy day, and call the Sabbath a delight, the holy of the Lord, honorable, and shalt honor him, not doing thine own ways, nor finding thine own pleasure, nor speaking thine own words, then shalt thou delight thyself in the Lord. And so I will cause thee to ride upon the high places of the earth, and feed thee with the heritage of Jacob, thy father, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken it. The Lord laid those things. I realize that they're there for the Jewish community, and part of that is yet to come to be fulfilled for them. But the Lord also gave that to me. And he said, they that be of thee shall build the old waste places. There was a time I took that so literally that I was actually driving around the county looking for old buildings that we might buy and fix up, especially after we got the annex building down the road and fix that up. But we'll be the repairers of the breach. Sunday school classes, Rangers, your girls' ministries, Christian Academy, regular church functions, repairing the breaches in the walls of our society, our culture, our lives. And they that be of thee are the ones that was going to do that. That would be you. And then all of your children shall be taught of the Lord, and great shall be the peace of thy children. And we've lived long enough and stuck to it long enough that we're now reaping the fruit of the trees, that he that tendeth the fig tree shall eat the fruit thereof. And as we have stayed the course, the trees have grown, they're producing fruit, and now we're going to have the chance to eat from those trees. And one of those trees happens to be a graduate of Fairton Christian Center Academy after having been homeschooled for several years by his wonderful mother, and as a graduate of Valley Forge Christian College. And so it's my great honor to introduce to you here and to those of you who are watching by television a young man that we have great confidence and faith in, Mr. David Smith.
I'm very honored to be here with you and to have the opportunity to preach. a pastor came to me and asked me if I would like to preach for him while I was on vacation. And of course, I said I'd be honored. I mean, you know, what else do you say when your pastor comes to you? And then he decided that they're not going to go on vacation. So that's when the nerves started kicking in. I was like, okay, pastor. But I had the opportunity to preach first service as well, and I wouldn't have any other way. I'm glad that you're here. And so after pastor asked me to preach, I was spending time, you know, thinking, okay, what am I going to preach on? And I was driving to work one day, and so I had these ideas going on in my head. Okay, I can preach on this, I can preach on that. And I'm sitting there driving, like, okay, Father, I want to preach what you would have me preach. You know, I don't want to preach my own wisdom. I don't want to preach my own thoughts. I want to honor you. So if you would, you know, let me know what you would have me preach on. And I hear that still small voice inside that says, preach on forgiveness. And I know it's God. And so, of course, my answer was no. And so, like, Daddy, I don't want to preach on that. I have these other ideas. You know, I already got the ideas working out and stuff. I don't want to preach on that. He's like, preach forgiveness. So I'm like, all right, by now I know, okay, I need to surrender, and I need to preach on what he has for me. So I'm going to believe that there's someone here, someone watching today needs to hear about forgiveness. So I was researching, thinking about forgiveness, looking up, and thinking on forgiveness, there's really two parts to forgiveness. There is being the person that is the forgiver, and then there's the one who is the forgiven, the person accepting the forgiveness. So we're going to speak on the two different parts today. We're going to talk on that. And so first we'll take on forgiveness, for being the one who gives the forgiveness and forgives. Now, it isn't always easy to forgive. You know, it can be a continual thing. Sometimes life is just tough. And there might be someone in our life that, you know, we just feel is not worthy of our forgiveness. And but it's something that should be taken very seriously. And Jesus spoke on this many times. And if you'd open your Bibles, we'll go to Matthew 6:14, verse 15. 6:14 and 15. And it says, "For if ye forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if ye forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive you your trespasses." And then again in Mark 11:25, it says, "And when ye stand praying, forgive if ye have aught against any, and that your Father also, which is in heaven, may forgive you your trespasses." Now, I don't know about you, but when I read these scriptures, it kind of hits me pretty hard, and I'm like, okay, well, I guess I should take forgiveness, you know, pretty seriously, that if I don't forgive someone who has wronged me, it says that my Heavenly Father won't forgive me. So, if I have a problem with somebody, I must forgive them, no matter how hard it is. And just to think that if I don't, my Heavenly Father won't forgive me, if we take that seriously, I mean, we should be talking, we should be contacting anyone we have any sort of problem with and just coming to them in humbleness and saying, okay, I need forgiveness. You know, can we work this out? I forgive you. But things would be great if forgiveness was worked as easy as saying, okay, I forgive you, forget it, it's over, you know. But sometimes it just isn't that easy. You know, there might be scars that, you know, take place from the hurt, the pain of having someone that we may even love very dear to us, hold very dear to us, and they hurt us. And that happens. And we choose to forgive them, you know, but sometimes maybe a week, month, years down the road, the enemy might come in and say, you remember when they did that to you? Do you remember that, you know, that pain that's still in there? They did you wrong. Like, you should, you know, you should do something about that, you know, because they don't care. They're messing with, you know, they're just going on with their life, and you're hurt from it. And, you know, in those moments, we have to choose to forgive. Maybe not so much for the other person, but to hold unforgiveness in ourselves. Unforgiveness can be like a cancer and eat away and cause you to become a bitter person and just take the life and joy out of your life. And ultimately, and prevent you from allowing the love of God to fulfill itself in your life, and you might not be able to be used as God sees in that moment, whatever it might be, because you're harboring unforgiveness within yourself. Now, what happens when someone continues to come to you asking for forgiveness, and then, you know, you forgive them, they go on, come back, do the same thing again, you know, it gets old. But the disciples, they struggle with this as well. And as we all know in the scripture, where Peter comes to Jesus and says, Master, it's like, you know, how many times do I have to forgive this person? You know, like seven times? And of course, Jesus says, no, not seven, but 70 times seven. Let's do the math, 490 times. And so, thankfully, though, when I come to God for forgiveness, he goes on beyond 490 times. Amen. And so you have to continue to walk in forgiveness. It's so easy to write that person off and say, you know, all right, you keep doing this to me, you keep hurting me, I don't want to deal with it. Goodbye. Okay? But that's not what God calls us to. And thankfully, that is not the way our Heavenly Father treats us and sees us. And thankfully, he truly forgives and forgets. And we're able to move on and walk in his love and forgiveness. And then the second part to forgiveness is being the forgiven and accepting forgiveness, specifically God's forgiveness. And so at this moment, though, I'd like to show a video that kind of ties all this in and kind of gives you an idea of what I'd like to speak on for the rest of this. So.
Times in my life when I felt God so close, it felt like his arms were wrapped around me and I could hear his voice so clearly. But honestly, there were times in my life in which I also felt like he was a million miles away, and I was doing my best to get to him, but I felt like nothing I could do could make it happen. And no matter how loud I would scream, that he couldn't hear me. And it was terrifying. But it was what I did in those moments that really defined my walk with God. You see, I had a choice about the way that I would react to the apparent distance between myself and my God. You know, some people react to moments like that by saying, I don't care how distant God feels, I know he's there. And they fix their eyes on him and they continue pursuing him. But some people, and this is even what I have done in my life, some people get so afraid that if they stumble, he won't be there to catch them. Some people get so afraid that they've been abandoned or let down or betrayed yet again that they refuse to move forward. That they wander off the narrow road and they say, Father, you're too far. I can't make it. And they give up. And I remember my son, whom I love more than anything, learning to walk. And I remember he would take a step or two and he would fall. And it would feel like he was alone. And I saw myself in that. You know, the times in my life in which I stumbled and I fell, and the times in my life in which I felt like my father should have caught me, but he didn't, were some of the most painful. But I had to face the reality that my God was not going to leave me to die. My God was not going to leave me to failure. My God was not going to abandon me because of my own inability, because he did not bring me here to abandon me. He brought me here to turn me into the man he created me to be. And I want you to think about that for your own life. Think about the way that your Father in heaven treats you, that sometimes maybe he takes a few steps back and it feels like he's far off and it feels like he's more distant than he used to be. But I tell you, if you turn your eyes up and if you see what he's really doing, you'll realize that the God of all creation has knelt down in front of you with his hands out and has said, "Beloved son, beloved daughter, I want you in my arms. Will you just fix your eyes on mine? Will you just stumble forward, continue putting one foot in front of the other? Because whether you believe it or not, sooner or later there will come a day, if you continue forward, that you'll fall into my loving arms. And that's what I'm waiting for. And I believe that's what the Father is waiting for." My name is Maddie Montgomery, and God calls me son.
God is good, amen?
Amen.
All right, so being the forgiven, like I said, I believe that God spoke to me and told me to talk on forgiveness today, to preach on forgiveness, so I'm going to believe that someone, you know, needs to hear this, that this is for somebody. Maybe it was for me because God was really working in my life this time up until this morning, and it was just reminding me of so much how he loves and forgives me. And, you know, like we sang in the hymns to everything this morning, it's nothing but the blood of Jesus, and, you know, he's a great God. But sometimes, though, at least it has been the case in my life, it's not always easy to accept forgiveness, and including the forgiveness of God and the love of God, because there's just some times in life where we feel like we've messed up. We've really messed up, and we knew better. And how could God continue to forgive me when I keep coming back to him, you know, and with these problems, with these mistakes that I have in my life? And but I'm going to read 1 John chapter 1. I believe the word of God to be true and is alive and well, and we serve a God who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And it says in 1 John that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I hold that to be true. Absolutely, I believe it with all my heart. There was a time where, you know, not to say I didn't believe it, it's not that I didn't know the scripture, it was just that it wasn't, you know, I didn't have my mind set on it. I didn't have my heart set on the reality of how much God truly loved me. And so sometimes, though, we forget how great our God is in our limited comprehension. Sometimes we just don't grasp at how great his love is. And honestly, truthfully, I don't know that we can ever grasp how great his love is for us. You know, how like comprehend the immense power of his love and his forgiveness. You know, it's not that I don't want to try to. It's just he's just that great. You know, he's beyond my comprehension, but he grants me opportunities and lets me grasp bits and pieces here and there about how much he actually does love me. You know, so but sometimes we feel like we've let him down and we are not worthy of his love and forgiveness. After all, you know, we as Christians were bought by the blood of Jesus, made into a new creation. We're his bride. So how could he continually forgive us even when we know better? And, you know, like I said, there are times, though, where I felt like I was not worthy of his love and forgiveness. And the truth of the matter is that I was not. I'm not worthy of his love and forgiveness. But that just goes to prove how great his love and kindness and mercy and forgiveness truly is, how great of a God we serve, that, you know, he would even consider to send his one and only perfect son that never messed up, never did the things I've done, and to send him to die for me when I never did anything worthy. You know, and it says in the scriptures that, like, even our best of deeds are considered like worthless rags. So even when I'm doing good, you know, in comparison, but he still loves us and he still continues to. One of my personal testimonies is, you know, that God loves and forgives. There was a time in my life where I was guilt-ridden, I was ashamed of things that I had done. And I had repented, I had asked forgiveness, you know, I plead with God, please forgive me, you know. And, you know, I know that he did and stuff, because I asked for forgiveness. Like it says, confess your sins, he's faithful and just to forgive. But it was just hard for me to accept that. You know, I felt like I needed to be punished. I felt like, you know, like I said, I wasn't worthy. Why should he forgive me? Why should he love me? And it was a time of depression in my life. And it was a series of events that had taken place. And for a year and a half, I felt like God didn't love me, that the people around me didn't love me. And now I know that's not true. My family loves me. Obviously, God loves me. I know that's not true. But in that time, Satan had just beat me down and continued to just get me to this place where I was just desperate. I wasn't considering suicide or anything, but I didn't want to exist. I had no joy in life. I didn't feel love for God. I didn't feel love for people. And that person who I knew myself to be, who God had created me to be, I wasn't that anymore. And I was desperate. I was every day. And I had begun to journal. And my journal would be like, God, save me. Take this from me. I want to live for you. I want to be loved by you again. I want to love people again, you know. And there would be times now I can look back at that and say, God, you were right there all along. I knew he was. But it felt like at times where it was just like holding on by a thread, and I didn't know where he was. And like that video showed, you know, as Maddie, his little boy, would, you know, run up to him and stuff, he'd fall. And I'm sitting there like he would be. I'm like, God, why didn't you catch me? You know, where were you? And stuff. And so I'm just like sitting and looking at the situation all around me. I'm not looking up to my father, to his loving eyes, with his outstretched arms waiting for me to just look up at him and accept that he loves me and that he forgives me. Now there was, like I said, it'd be a daily thing where I'm just asking, begging God to forgive me for, you know, he already had, but I didn't understand, I didn't comprehend how much he actually loved me. And there was one day, I was training for cross country, and I was running. I went for a jog down Middle Ferreton Road, and it was a summer day. It was beautiful outside, but usually on my runs and stuff, I'm just like, you know, there's not much else to do. You can listen to music or you have your thoughts. So, and I'm just once again asking, praying, God, pleading with him. God, please, you know, forgive me. I want to love life again. I want to love you. And the whole time, my thoughts and my heart, my mind was set on the things and my situation. When, like I said, I was supposed to be looking up to my father and seeing the love in his eyes. And so I was running down the Old Ferrant Road, and God just grabs my attention. And in the middle of my run, I just look over, and there's this field there, and there's just a thing of flowers, some plants and stuff. I hear God speak to me. And he says, "My son, my child." It's like, look at these flowers. Look how intricate and beautiful they are. I created those. Just like I created you. And if I put so much time and like effort, I designed those perfectly. How much more so did I perfectly and intricately design you? And I broke down. It's just like the presence of God just came in, and he opened my eyes to just truly how much he loves me. And not just that, how great of a God he is, that he could create something like those flowers, like me, you know? And if the God of all the universe who created heaven and earth, you know, if he knows me, and he loves me enough to take the time to, you know, to smell the flowers with me, then, you know, I just gotta accept it. And so, like I said, I just accepted his love. And it's hard to accept the forgiveness when you don't feel like you're loved by God, you know? And so, I don't think that we can fully comprehend how much he truly loves us. But in that moment, he gave me a grasp of how truly great our God is. And so now I can stand before you and say that I serve a great God. I serve the creator of heaven and earth. He loves me, and he has a plan for my life. Hallelujah. You know? And I can just say, like, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Great is the Lord and worthy of praise, who established his throne forever. He's worthy, and he loves everyone in this building. Oh, sorry, it's just, I guess, the presence of God, and he's done so many great things for me, and he's always there. I know he is and stuff, and like I said, there was times where I felt like I was holding on to a thread, and looking back, I know he was always there, and just my eyes weren't looking up to him. So now I can say to you, I am a son of God, and I know who I am. I know who he is, how much he loves me. So I just thank you all for the opportunity to share my heart. And you know, if there's anyone at home watching this on the internet, or you know, Thursday, there's people ready to pray with you. And you know, if you're going through a place of depression, or just a place of feeling unloved, and that there is no one, there are plenty of people here. There's some of the most loving and real people that I know. I call them, they're my family. And they're waiting for your call, and they love to talk to you. And we're praying for you. And I almost forgot, actually. I was working the other night. I work overnights at Wawa, and Christy called me. And I was asleep, and she called and was like, "David, there's a lady that would like prayer." I'm like, okay, make a note of it. So I wasn't gonna remember, but I believe her name was Denise, and she was in Princeton, and she was just given the diagnosis. She has ovary cancer, I believe, cancer of the ovaries. So we'd like to pray for her and lift her up. So just, dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you. Thank you for your love and your kindness and your mercy. And I just pray for Denise, and I just lift her up, Lord. We pray for healing. And we pray for victory in the name of Jesus. There's no other name. There's no more powerful name. And we thank you for the love of your son. And we just ask that you would be with Denise in this certainly time of seemingly darkness. But you are the light. And we just ask that you would shine into her life, give her overwhelming peace and comfort, and the joy of knowing that she serves a great God and that you love her. And we pray for victory in Jesus' name. Amen.
I was sitting right there in that chair beside David, and the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, ask David to speak. And David sought God, and the Lord told him, speak on forgiveness. That means that there's either people at home that needed that message, or there's possibly people here that need that message. And I would say that there are people here that need that message. You've all been told that God loves you, and you might even believe that, but you come up against spirits that attack you and parade before you all your mistakes, all your weaknesses, and try to tell you that you're unworthy and no good and not capable of receiving the love of God. It's a lie. And so the Holy Spirit has ministered through David to all of us here. So why don't we stand? And I'm going to ask David if he would come again. And if you're here and you've been struggling with that, that's no shame to have the enemy hate you enough to attack you. In fact, the Bible says rejoice whenever that begins to happen. If you're here and you've been struggling with what David ministered on, just I'm not going to bring you up here or anything, not trying to embarrass you. Just shoot your hand up. Okay, that's here. And God gave you that message, and you pray for them, and you pray against the spirits that are attacking.
Father, I just thank you for everyone here. I thank you for your love and your kindness and your mercy, and that you're always there with outstretched arms. And I'm sorry that sometimes, you know, our eyes drift away, and we don't realize that you're there with your outstretched arms. Father, we ask that you would grab our attention with your love and kindness and mercy. Pull us up into your arms. I just pray for everyone here. I pray for victory in the name of Jesus, that the spirits of depression, anxiety, of oppression, whatever might be coming against them, we pray for victory in the name of Jesus. Their spirits have no control here. They are children of the living God, bought by the blood of Jesus. They are made new. I pray for victory in Jesus' name. I thank you, Lord.